three fascinating talks. And we're moving on to our next, the next part of our panel to the website.
So, first of all, thank you very much. Reading all the papers and listening to you. It was a very eclectic panel, I have to say. One needs to deal here both with discipline, different disciplines, then moving from Ethiopia to Rome, then moving from antiquity to modernity and back forward. And so in that sense, but I really, really enjoyed all the papers, and I read them carefully. And I must say, when reading them, I thought that all of you are speaking, and I don't know if you know the notion, and we have the privilege, but I'm meeting in 2 days, I'll start with that. Okay, I'm meeting in 2 days a good friend of mine, who actually responded on my book a year ago, by the name of Hans-Ulrich Gombrecht. Gombrecht is a rather famous, or very famous, philosopher, cultural studies scholar, thinker. And he actually, versus Kozelek to a certain extent, and Kozelek speaks very much, and Moll mentioned him, Kozelek speaks very much about the notion of, I would say, not only him, by the way, it's what modernity projects to us. What, I would say this, it's what the 90s project to us. The 90s project to us an open future, okay? 45 plus, 1945 at least, let's say this, there's an open future. I'm just idealizing this. But Gombrecht, and that is interesting, I think, for the whole conference, perhaps, he speaks about a closed future. So he calls this the broad present, in a sense. And I think it's a very interesting notion, because it brings sort of this, and I, by the way, I do not totally agree with this sort of broad present, or I would say closed future notion, but I think it's very important as a mechanism to think about visions of the past, but also of the present. So he basically says that things from the past, like someone who's been traumatized, for instance, are actually drawn into his presence and then reflect on his closed future. And I think that is very important to all of you. I mean, if I see a sort of something that I can see in all of your papers, is that sort of notion. Of course, you have different perspectives. With that, I think I wanted really to start with this one before I will sort of engage more individually with each one. Another thing which I think is very important is the fact that I enjoyed, I totally believe in study cases. I totally believe in delving into particular historical notions. Even though I'm in international relations and European studies, I'm a historian, but in the social sciences. There are historians in this and I think there should be more historians. That's but what I wanted to say is that basically you are speaking from a very sort of meta-historical notion. And I would say this is following a bit what the historical, I don't know if you read the historical manifesto, or the Manifesto of History, I can't remember the exact title now, I read the whole notion, it's a very important book, but basically it's about taking or returning back to long-durée histories. And I think all of you are engaged with this. I think it's very important. It's very important, and it's a turn. So we speak about the global turn, but another very important element we need to speak about to success is the, I would say, the returning or the turn back to notions of long duet. But then, that makes a lot of problems. Because you are not facing sometimes certain realities that need to be approached very carefully. Now, I'm not sure if you engage with it, you guys engage with these things carefully or not, but I just want to raise several questions. So, first of all, for Peter, you go, it's again, very extended time, from Herodotus to the first century. If my Latin was better, my dream was really to be an ancient historian. So I have Latin, but you know, I was stuck with the German and then became modern, you know, but 90%, if you deal with 90% like I do, everything is ancient, you know. So, the only ancient history, you know what they say, the only ancient history, the history is the 19th century. There's no other century. But, that's my bias. Anyway, but saying that, I want to give you to what struck me straight away is, and perhaps you will deal with it, but I want you to push you on that. One is Polybius, which is missing. But Polybius is central to this notion with the anacyclosis. So basically the turn, I don't know if you know the notion of anacyclosis, so basically the cycle of regimes. Cycle of regimes into a very sort of a cyclical, but very linear time. And I think he refers to the Roman Republic. Right? He's writing this while they are, Polybius, of course, living in the 2nd century BC. He's writing this while they are victorious over Carthage. And basically, it's not only Carthage, but all the, and this, if you, you know, yeah, Adolphi, so basically, right now. So I want you to push you on that, and I would refer to Polybius and to the Republic. And another thing which I think is crucial here is having the, well, Quintin Skinner did this, you know, with text and context. But when you refer to Dionysius of Halicarnassus, especially to Patroclus, this is a time when indeed, and I think this goes to worry what you're saying, on the one hand, there's great success of the Roman Empire, but saying that, there's also the greatest tragedy or havoc of Roman history. And now I'm referring to the year 980, when Augustus wakes up every night and comes to and shouts out, Quintilius Varus, where are my three legions? So basically, this is the first time that he comes out every night. It's depicted in different sources. Where are my three legions? It's the, really the first, one of the first times, except perhaps Bar Kokhba, when they come to the, if I'm not mistaken, they come to the parliament, and then you have Dio Cassius there, reporting is the first time that there wasn't peace on the legions. But that's exactly a thing where, okay, we are expanding, we are winning, we have a change of regimes from a republic to an empire, we have a sort of good future, but then the greatest havoc ever, I would say, one of the greatest ones is happening there. And I want to, like, you know, and if I'm not mistaken, but maybe I'm wrong on that I did not check. I think it's Florus, right, is living a bit later, but reporting on the defeat in the Teutoburger Wald, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. If I'm mistaken, perhaps I'm mistaken there. And I do not know if they reported it. I mean, Dionysius is a bit earlier, but Valerius is,
yeah. Exactly.
But what I want to say is that the main point is not the case, but it's, again, this connection between events and this broken, basically what you meant is the open future together with the closed future. That's what you gave us, to continue my earlier thoughts. Okay, so I think on that it's very, very important. Okay, so that is how much time do I have? I can speak on Rome for eternity.
Not eternity.
No, I can speak on Rome, but I don't know if I'm saying it wise, of course. Dejan, so thank you very much. So I think it was very interesting. And what strikes me here is actually your beruf, so basically your profession, and your historical beliefs, because I totally relate with it. In a sense, I think that every lawyer is a historian. Okay, I would say that's my statement. I can back it up, especially when we're building it, sitting in the faculty of law. But I want to say it was exactly in the 19th century, and that is very interesting to what you said. That actually, I'll give you an individual that I'm working on a lot. His name is James Price. He was a historian and a lawyer, and he's the one that actually, in his time and under his religious professorship, so law and history were divided. So to a certain extent, history and law were combined up until the 19th century, especially in the House of Oxbridge. Okay, that's something which is important. I think it's very relevant.
Sure.
Because what these people tried always to do is actually through the vision of the constitutional law, or the history of constitutional law, actually going back to a long durée of the Roman Empire. And that is very interesting. You know where Bryce starts his chronology of the Roman Empire? He starts it with Julius Caesar. So basically it says, Roman Empire started in, let's say, 44, 40, depending how you count and what you count, let's say 27 BC, Augustus, going all the way, you know, until when? Until 1804-6, AD. The fall of the Holy Roman Empire, which was, of course, not holy, not Roman Empire. But then, in the next version, the Bryce writes, and he comes always from the vision of law. He sees history as a lawyer, constitutional law, emerging law. With the next version, when there's the unity of Wilhelm under Prussia of Germany, suddenly the lineage continues. So it doesn't stop in 1804, 1806, but continues. So basically, he sees history as a long durée of Roman, an eternal Roman sort of habitus, one could say. But now I'm pushing you on this. And I want to, okay, you gave us the three periods, which were very, really interesting. And there's two notions. One is, where is the law? I mean, constitution. So I want to hear, I mean, you brought us history, but I want you to bring me law a bit and tell me, and I know it's different. And now another thing I thought about is this narrative of independence and freedom, which is without all the African state entities in Ethiopia, perhaps Liberia a bit, but Ethiopia, Libya a bit, but Ethiopia, I think, more than anyone else. That is the constructive narrative of its history. So basically, no foreign rule. We beat the British, we beat the Italians, well, we lost the Italians later, but we have this sort of victory, and it stands. It's always sort of the main thing that, as I know, without knowing anything or enough about Ethiopian history, I think that is the narrative that I did. And this is very interesting. I think you should even state more, because I think it's very, very important there. Because all the time it's this narrative. And why is it important? It's also important not only against imperialism and colonialism, it's also important against the other sort of African states, which do not have enough this narrative of freedom. And this is where Ethiopia, I would say, sort of, if I struggle the whole narrative, this is where Ethiopia is really, really unique. And this is why your story is unique, and that's why I think you should even emphasize it, give much more emphasis to it. Okay, that is something. Okay, I have still more time. Okay. So, Karen, so I know all of your work. I also read it now again. I think I read the piece of you. We discussed it before and so on. And here I want to raise a question, which I would say is very much important to dealing with future sort of projections of peace agreements. First of all, I would say this. I want to offer, maybe I'm totally wrong about this, that it's actually conflicts that lasted for, which are old, could better project on the future.
Could better.
So basically, as far as you go back in history, it's an offer, because I'm thinking of Ireland especially, and there's more examples. But as long as you go back in history, because of the remoteness, perhaps, of the deeds, then it's a possibility. I don't think it's applicable to all cases. It's just something I want you to perhaps think about. And this is why the past still matters, because it projects in the future. So what I want to, perhaps I'm totally wrong, especially in the case of Ireland. Ireland is not a 40 years conflict. It's not even a 200 years conflict. Ireland goes back, in general, I would say, to Queen Elizabeth I with the plantations. And it's not only a narrative of the past that people say, no. People in the 16th century observed the English, or especially because of the religious difference, according to to such. So I wouldn't really generalize this sort of observation on every other case, but I want to offer that in some cases, perhaps the further you go back, then you have more possibility actually to go to the future, because the past really does not matter in a sense, in the real sense. Just an offer, because it's so long, and of course it has the IRA, it has the near history, but that past, that sort of long journey behind us, or we'll suggest an alternative which will actually give us a better future. Of course, a counter example is, is here. A place where we cannot, I'm marginalizing psychology. I'm not a psychologist, but I would say this anyway. When I think on trauma, I think there is, you mentioned psychology a lot, but as far as I know, sometimes as long as you go, it does make a difference. It doesn't matter, especially nations, how nations perceive trauma. Here, Israel, Palestine, the open wound does not allow any closure, hence, and the proximity between the events and the process. I would say we do not allow, as I see it, any sort of future handlings, because we are still being formed by by the conflict. Now, if I, again, perhaps only compare Ireland and Palestine, Israel, I would say this. The fact that the Catholic Protestant, I would say, antagonism is really not an issue of 20th century Europe in most places, is meaningful there. It's very, unfortunately, it's not meaningful here. Here, the religious aspect, I think it's a territorial dispute, first of all, that should have been solved. It hasn't been sold, but could have been sold, I would say, years ago. But the whole religious, I would say, character of this conflict does not allow any sort of. So there's two points here. There's the religious one, and the proximity between the longer the event goes. Of course, there's exceptions. When I think on the Basque, but also with the Basque and the Catalonia now, of course, there's all the time cries for independence. Now, it goes actually more to the Irish camps than to the Israeli-Palestine camps, I would claim. It goes to a future. Okay, they want, but then there's another thing. What's interesting there is that another claim that could be given here, and this is why sometimes when I said one needs to be very careful, it does meta-history or meta-generalizations, is that every case is really different. In the case of Balkan, Spain, I mean Catalonia and Baskeland, I would say that the fact that every other entity there is Catholic is actually did not allow them to be separate from the mother entity. Now you say Portugal and so on, but Portugal is another reason why it's separate. So the two points here, are we talking on a banal, sort of what I can be almost say a banal nationalism or a hot nationalism? Are we speaking on something? And I think the events of how much time we have behind us will project on perhaps on our imagination of a better future. Yeah, so I think I will finish with this, and I would really, really urge you all to think of these categories between of an open future and a closed future, because it's also put things under a certain kind of category. Now, what another very important thing I think which I did not see enough, but perhaps I'm wrong because I didn't see the whole one, but is the sort of Especially this refers to Dejan and Peter in the sense because you do more of historical work in that sense. But one needs, I think, to understand, and I see it, but the different mechanism of how we divide time into periods. So in your case, Dejan, it's really about national time. National time has a certain unique realizations which are not totally equivalent to what one could say imperial time or global time or Western time in terms of realization. And the Rome is a totally different, of course. This is what we can call Western time, what became Eurocentralized time, which is totally not a global time, but we perceive it as the global, still, with our Western eyes, still perceive this as. And that's one category I really think one needs to differentiate. How is this playing towards, you know, different aspects of time, of periodizations within the national, the imperial sphere? Because on Ethiopia, it's also the empirical, I would say, and as well as the national. In that case, well, it's rather different. And one last point, perhaps, is about the notion of the Roma Eterna. And this is the big two narratives. I'm not sure I totally agree, convinced me maybe I'm wrong, that always we perceive Rome, you know, as eternal. Because what happens is, of course, all these regimes, Karlmann, Charlemagne, Carlos Magnus, who else? Russia, Austro-Hungary, Germany to a certain extent. Even Britain, you know, I don't know, the coronation last week you saw, he was wearing purple. It's a very reason why they're purple. Anyway, all this regime, okay, they see Rome as a, you know, this is the model, this is what we can call the fourth monarchy of Daniel, which actually extended into modernity. It was always there. Translato Imperi, but the same empire. So it's not Translato Imperi, it's actually the same empire. But it's just through a magical, sort of, magical, mystical notion goes forward. That's one point. But on the other hand, all these regimes always are still, especially modernity, I speak about more convincingly about modernity, they're always fearful that this will end. So it's not something I would say, think of Gibbon. You know, in the decline and the fall, it's not the rise and decline, it's the decline and fall. He like buries this, he buries Rome into history, but it still continues. So I would, again, that's another question. Is it really that sort of eterna, or because you're trying to present sort of a more mixed picture, which was very interesting, but I want you to answer. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.